Today is the feast day of St. Mary Magdalene. After the sermon, conclude our devotions in church this morning with the devotion to St. Anthony, the 13 Tuesdays of St. Anthony, and you'll receive the sheet to be able to say those prayers. Boys, I welcome you to our summer camp this year, and I hope that it will not only be fun and enjoyable for you, but I hope that you will learn some things too, you always do, and most of all, that you will learn the things that matter most of all. Now, you boys are too young, and indeed, your fathers, some of your fathers are with you this morning, they're too young to remember the worst war in history. It was called World War II. It happened about over 60 years ago now. My father was in that war, and I remember him telling me a little bit about it when I was a boy. Over 50 million people were killed in that war. It wasn't a war that was fought in our land. It was fought in Europe and also in Asia. 50 million people were killed, and the Blessed Mother predicted that entire nations would be wiped out. And so they were, conquered by the communists at the end of this war. It was a terrible war, indeed. War comes, children, as a punishment for sin. And actually, the Blessed Mother appeared to three children, Fatima, and she gave them a plan, and if only at least everybody had followed the plan, especially important people in the church like the Pope, well, then there wouldn't have been the war. But nobody wanted to, so I'm afraid that the war took place. And while the war was not fought in this country, many young men, and some young women too, but mostly young men from our land, had to go overseas and fight in the war. First of all, they would go someplace in this country to be trained, and then they would go overseas. Well, the first scene usually was a very sad goodbye at a train station. I don't know if you've ever been to Union Terminal downtown, but Union Terminal back then was the bustling equivalent of an airport. And there were thousands of people that would go in and out of it each day in the trains. The trains would take the boys. Some of them were not that much older than yourself. They were just 18. Away to war, to be trained to fight in the war. And then they would be sent to Europe or to Asia. And it was a very sad scene to say goodbye to the boys because the parents didn't know. Will I ever see you again? Will you get wounded in the war? Will you be killed in the war? Or maybe that the parents themselves would die or something would happen to them and they might never meet again in this life. And so at these scenes of goodbye at the train station, there was a lot of weeping going on and a lot of sadness in everyone's heart. There was one man in particular, I read this story last night, there was one man who was an older man and he only had one son. And this son had to go off to fight in World War II. And he, as sometimes dads do, he couldn't think really of too much to say, but his heart was very full. So were his eyes. His eyes were full of tears. He was very sad. He just said goodbye. But then he realized, I have to say something more to my son than just goodbye. But whatever could I tell him? In the meantime, the train's whistle was sounding, and all of the boys had gotten on the train, and his son, his name was John. Johnny was going on the train too, and said, Johnny, don't get killed. But then he realized, I've got to say something more to him than just that. I know he wouldn't want to get killed, of course nobody would, but in the meantime the crowd is cheering and everybody's trying to encourage the troops who are leaving, and he's his son who's they used to do. You used to get by a window and they used to crowd out the window to see if they could see their family, say goodbye to him just at the very end. He sees his son, Johnny, and he runs up to him and he thinks finally of what he wants to say. And he says, son, don't get killed. Don't get killed. Stick close to the general. And it was all. The train pulled away. He did. He actually ended up getting a job as a driver for the general. Generals don't usually get killed in war. It was excellent advice from his father. only the soldiers be killed in the war. And so he stayed close to the general, and he came home a few years later, and he saw his dad again. He stayed close to the general. Boys, we're not here for fun and games. Boys, we are here in the battle of life. And all of you, if I'm not mistaken, are already enrolled as soldiers of Christ. You are confirmed. You are a soldier of Christ now. You know that every day you must fight to save your soul in order to win heaven. Who's the enemy? Is it the Germans, the Japanese, or the communists, or the Russians? Your enemy is the devil. He's fighting to make you lose your soul. And that is why you have to fight very hard in order to save your soul. And I say to you today, don't get killed. How are you not going to get killed? Stick close to the general. Who's the general? Jesus Christ, our Lord and King. Where is he? In the tabernacle. You have, most of you just received him just now in Holy Communion. When I say stick close to the general, I mean stick close to our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament and in Holy Communion. Now, boys, you know that your parents love you very much. In some cases, I think one could almost say that your parents live for you, and they would do anything that they could for you. You know that your priests love you very much, too, your teachers, and all of your family. We would do anything to help you out. But sometimes, I'll tell you this, we do worry about you a little bit. Yes, we do. We wonder, where will you be 5 years from now? Where will you be 10 years from now? Where will you be 15 years from now? Will your soul be already lost? Will you be killed in some battle by the devil? It's the battle of life. Boys, it's worth worrying about and remembering that every day we have to fight in it. We wouldn't worry about you, not nearly so much, if we could be sure that your whole life long, this year, and I mean next year and the year after that, that you would always stick close to the general. Who's the general? Jesus, in the Blessed Sacrament. I know a boy. Well, he's not a boy anymore now. No, he's a young man, I suppose. He's a young man who, I think that I baptized him, and I certainly saw him every year of his life as he was growing up. He was at our school for a number of years, and I saw him when he was in kindergarten, and I trained him how to be an altar boy, and all of the rest. And he, like anyone else, like each one of you, he was in the battle. But I saw him starting to lose the battle, and it worried me very much. Sometimes we talked to him, and we corrected him. Sometimes we punished him. Nothing seemed to do much good. I'm afraid that sometimes as an altar boy, he was very irreverent on the altar. We're soldiers, boys. The soldiers were respectful. We don't slouch in church. For starters, we sit up straight. And when we come back from Holy Communion, we're soldiers. We have our hands folded like this. Not like this. Not like that. Like this. We're soldiers. We know how to behave ourselves in church. We show reverence to our Lord. Just as on the altar, you wouldn't dream of looking out at the people in the church or laughing or joking or trying to get someone's attention. All that stuff would be terrible to do. Well, I'm afraid this boy did. And sometimes he would just pretend that he was going to communion to fool his father without really going. And later on, he would lie to his father and say, I've been to Mass today, when he really didn't go to Mass at all. And by the time his father found out of all of this, I'm afraid that it was too late. It was way too late. Now he's not only strayed from the general, he's not at his side anymore. I'm afraid that this boy has betrayed the general. He's gone over to the enemy's camp. He even told his father, I want to go and talk to that bishop sometime. Oh, you do, son? Well, that's good. And he said, yes, I want to talk to him and tell him that all of those things that he told me were sins all those years, that's not true at all. Everything's just fine. He works for the devil now. He's joined the enemy's side. Boys, how on earth are you going to be careful that that doesn't happen to you? Well, it's very simple. Today, you will stay close to the general. And tomorrow, and the next day. And every time you come into church, every time you see the tabernacle, and certainly at every Mass and Holy Communion, whether you are serving on the altar or in the pews, you will remember that you are a soldier of Christ. And you will stay close to Him in your thoughts, in your prayers, in your reverence and respect. If during your life, boy, you never give up making a good confession so you can go to Holy Communion, if in your life you're willing to make a sacrifice sometime to serve Mass so you can stick close to the general, or to attend Mass and to receive an extra Holy Communion, then I am confident you won't be killed in the battle of life. Now, as you start to grow up, it might seem to you it's a wonderful thing and lots of fun and exciting and all of the rest in the battle of life. And it's true. It is. But remember, if you get killed, that means if you commit a mortal sin and you stay in mortal sin and you die that way, you lose everything. The greatest evil in life, boy, is to commit a mortal sin. You lose everything. You'll never see your father or your mother or brothers and sisters or our Lord or our Lady or the saints. You won't see them if you die that way, because you would have to go to hell. Be punished in the flames there forever and ever. Serious thing, children, the battle of life. That's why we enrolled when you were very young with your confirmation to be brave soldiers of Christ. Children, today we keep the feast day of a saint who followed the advice of Johnny's father perfectly. Stick close to the general. Her name is Saint Mary Magdalene. Those of you who are seated over here, you can see her statue. We've got some candles burning by it today. She's a very great saint. What made her to be so great? She was loyal to our Lord. She sticked close to the general her whole life long. At some point when she was young, she got into trouble. But fortunately, our Lord came and helped her, and he drove the devils out of her. She was possessed by 7 devils, and he drove the devils out of her. Later on, to show her gratitude, she found out where our Lord was. He was having dinner at somebody's house, and this somebody was a Pharisee who actually hated our Lord. And she didn't care, because she knew that our Lord was there, and so she went there very bravely, and she washed our Lord's feet with her tears to show she was sorry for her sins. And she wiped them with her hair and anointed them with very valuable ointment or perfume that cost thousands of dollars. She did that again, Mary Magdalene did, at her brother's house just before Palm Sunday. And again, she spent thousands of dollars on Christ to show how much she loved him and how loyal to him she wanted it to be. She stayed with the general. The apostles didn't. Peter, he said, I don't know him. And Judas, he accepted 13 pieces of silver to betray him. And the rest, they ran away and they locked the door. They were afraid that the Jews would come and arrest them too. But she stayed with our Lord. And when they scourged Christ as a pillar, he was all covered with blood. Mary Magdalene was brave enough to kneel down and wipe up all of our Lord's precious blood so it wouldn't be treated sacrilegiously. And she stayed at the cross. She knelt right there at the foot of the crucifix the whole 3 hours that Christ hung there on the cross. And as soon as she could on Easter morning, she came with more ointment or perfume to anoint our Lord's body. The interesting thing about Mary Magdalene is that she didn't understand the general strategy. She didn't understand his tactics. She didn't quite realize that he was going to die for us and rise again from the dead. Oh, our Lord had told everybody that, but like children, they weren't listening. They weren't understanding. But never mind. She loved our Lord. That's what counted. She stayed close to him the whole time. And so early in the morning of Easter, when she found the tomb empty, she didn't leave. She stayed there. And finally, our Lord appeared to her. She thought he was the gardener, but it was our Lord. And then our Lord called her by name. And our Lord rewarded her because she stayed close to him the whole time. And she said, he said to her, go now and you tell the 12 apostles that I've risen from the dead and I'll meet them in Galilee. Go off to Galilee and I'll see them there. She did. She became the apostle of the apostles. Now she understands and now she believes. Children, that's the beauty of St. Mary Magdalene. She stuck close to the general and she was rewarded for it. If you will, you will be as well. That's the whole of our life, children. That's the best advice in the world. Stick close to the general. Now, before we conclude, because it's Tuesday, now we're going to have our devotion to St. Anthony. The seminarian will pass out the prayers, and we'll say those prayers together. God bless you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.